Okay, good morning students. Today today we will be studying about plant domestication. Today we will be studying about plant domestication in Principles of Plant Breeding course. This domestication topic is very important. So before going into the detail, we should know before going into the details of various principles of plant breeding, we should know that what is plant domestication. And in the same topic, today's topic, we will also be studying about selection. What is selection? What is the definition? Along with that, what are the different types of selection and population also? So these things we will be covering in the today's topic. Now, what is plant domestication actually? Okay, so plant domestication, we can understand it by, since we should know that all the cultivated species which are present now, they have all originated from the wild and weedy species. Okay, so when the humans have started agriculture about 10,000 or 11,000 years ago, when the humans have actually started agriculture and growing the wild species, they have been growing, and then at that particular time only the domestication has started. So the present day cultivated plants, they have been derived from wild weedy species. All the cultivated plants or the crop species which are present with us today, they are all derived from, they have all originated from the wild weedy species. So the first step in the development of the cultivated plant, we can say it is domestication. It was domestication. Okay, so the definition of domestication, we can say as, it is domestication is bringing the wild species under human management. Okay, so bringing the wild species under human management, when humans started managing the wild species and changing the characters of those plants according to their desirable needs, according to their usefulness. So that time only domestication of crop species started. So we can say, which began nearly about 10,000 years ago, when the humans actually started agriculture. Okay, so it was found that the people first domesticated plants about 10,000 years ago between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers of Mesopotamia. Okay, so these were the findings, that how the domestication of the wild species by humans started in agriculture. It started near the rivers in Mesopotamia. The first domesticated plants in Mesopotamia were wheat. So this was a civilization which had actually started cultivating the wild species according to their needs. So what were the various crops that they had started? Like, they were wheat, barley, lentils, and the types of peas. Okay, the areas were the Eastern Asia, parts of Asia, Africa, North and South America. Okay, so they had first domesticated the wild species of wheat, barley, lentils, and from that time only the domestication of various field crops have started. We can say that. So the process of bringing the wild species under human management is referred to as plant domestication. This we have understood till now. So when the domestication had started, so the humans started growing wild species in the farms. They started growing wild species in the farms. So it had led to the changes in the physical characteristics. What it led to? It led to the changes in the physical characteristics of the plants. And the plants became dependent on the human for their reproduction or for their propagation. Okay, so the plants, the humans started propagation of those wild species according to their needs. So whatever was their desirable traits, they started doing modification in those plants according to their needs. So it led to the changes. It led to the various changes in the plants, like physical characteristics of the plants have been changed. So here we can say that there are, if we take the example of Asian rice, there are two types of rice. First is Asian rice and the second one is African rice. Okay, so there are two types of rice. First is Asian rice and African rice. So Asian rice, if we take, which we consume, So it was first domesticated since 8000 BC. In 8000 BC, the humans first started domesticating the Asian rice. Asian rice originated in India, Thailand, and southern China. So it is believed that where it has been originated, the Asian rice has originated in India or in Thailand and in southern China. So these were first seen here in these countries. It was first domesticated in the regions of Yangtze River Valley in China. Okay, so it first domesticated in China in the river valley of this was a river, Yangtze River Valley in China. Similarly, African rice, the other type of rice was the African rice, which is mainly consumed in the African countries. So it was first independently domesticated about 3000 years ago in the river Niger Delta. So this was a river in Africa. So it was first domesticated. The African rice was first domesticated in this river. It's used mainly. It was used for the ritualistic purpose, that is for the festivals by the devotees as a treatment in African traditional medicine. So it mainly this type of African rice was used for the treatment of various diseases. It was used for the medicinal purpose. So this is the map showing the spread of rice cultivation from where it started the domestication of rice had spread to almost all the countries after that. Now coming to the second example of domestication is wheat. So there are about 25,000 different species of wheat. Till now we have 25,000 different types of species of wheat. And the archaeologists do not really know known that when it actually the domestication of wheat, how it started and when it had started. So, but they say that nearly about 12,000 to 23,000 years ago. See how long, so the period is so long that it took about 5,000 years to be domesticated. So before that, it was present in the wild form only. Genesis agreed that wheat was domesticated in the mountain regions of Turkey. So today, what country is called as Turkey? So the Genesis, they agree that wheat was domesticated in these regions. Also, wheat is the second most cultivated crop of the world. Okay, so it is the most cereal crop, which is mostly cultivated. It is the second most after rice. Civilizations that depend. So before that, there were a lot of civilizations like Mesopotamia or the Indus Valley civilization. So the oldest civilization is known to have depended on wheat in Syria, and there are remains of wheat in China, Greece, Roman, and England also. So before that, it was present in the wild forms in the various countries. Okay, so because we actually don't know that Genesis, they do not know actually how it started, how we started domestication. So these are just the predictions. So the remains that have been found in these regions. Difference between the wild wheat and the domestic wheat. So what is the main difference between the wild wheat and the domestic wheat? The oldest wheat, also known as the wild wheat means the oldest wheat which we have seen is the strain of wheat that wasn't domesticated. Okay, so that was not domesticated, but it was present in the wild form in the nature. So wild wheat is also known as acorn. You must be knowing about Norman Borlaug. He is a geneticist. He was the scientist who got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of the he was responsible for the Green Revolution in India, in the world. Sorry. So he was a humanitarian. He was a geneticist, and he was also the Nobel laureate who has been called the father of Green Revolution in agriculture. So he's also known as the father of Green Revolution. He created a new strain of wheat that has saved over a billion lives. He has a lot of work on dwarf means whose height is small, because the tall varieties of wheat, they are very susceptible for lodging. Okay, so the development by Norman Borlaug of the dwarf variety of wheat led to the revolution in the field of wheat. And he was also given the Nobel Prize for his work. Now coming to the third example, that is corn domestication. Corn is maize domestication. So we could see how the corn was also domesticated. The corn is one at the right. All these changes means see the earlier the corn were when the corn was in the wild species, was in the wild form. So the physical characteristics of those corns were different to those of the cultivated species which are present with us now, because the humans have done a lot of physiological or the physical changes in the characteristics by have been done in corn by humans, which are suiting our needs. Okay, so all these changes, so this was the wild form which was present earlier, and now after so much of development and through agricultural modifications which the scientists or after the domestication has happened, so the altogether the corn, the physical characteristics have also been changed apart from the genetic characteristics. All these changes that corn presents from its wild grass ancestor have been produced by plant domestication. So all these, because if we have not started cultivation of domestic cultivation of corn, then we would have still we would have the wild species only. So the domestication is also very important step that the agriculture that that have been done by the humans. So that is also, we can say that domestication is an artificial selection which was done by humans. So here the corn was domesticated about 8700 years ago, and studies concept, just you have to remember that the example of corn domestication, and scientists since then, means after the domestication of corn, it has led to a lot of changes in the physical characteristics of the corn. Scientists discovered that Belsaz river of teosinate was the most similar to corn because they did a DNA test with both. So the scientists, they have discovered that corn was first domesticated near the Belsaz river. Similarly, fourth example is bean. Bean was also, the common bean is the most important legume, domestic legumes in the world. Legumes are the most important sources of protein that are present with us, and they have been consumed in a huge amount in the world. So they are the most important domestic legumes in the world. Okay, so the beans earlier the domestication process has started in beans. They were present in the wild forms in the nature. Beans were domesticated in two places, the Andes Mountains of Peru and Lerma Santiago Basin of Mexico. So it was believed that it was first domesticated in these areas. So you just have to remember the points. You should know these four examples I have shown you just to explain you well that how the different crop species have been originated from their wild forms. Okay. And after domestication, a lot of artificial selection is being done by humans through domestication to bring about a lot of changes in their characteristics. So the main difference between the wild and the cultivated beans are, well, domestic beans are less exciting. Of course, there is a significant increase in the seed weight. So after the domestication has started from the wild species, there are a lot of changes take place inside the cultivated ones, okay, from the wild ones. So the one significant change was increase in the seed weight. Fifth example is potato domestication. Potato, as we all know today, is far different than the first seen by humans many years ago. So potato cultivation has been done from so many years ago. Okay, and what we see potato or the different varieties of potato, what we see, that is mainly due to the domestication of potato that was done by humans through artificial means. So the first people to encounter the potato were those located along the west coast of South America towards the end of the last ice age. So it was first domesticated in South America. This is just for your general information that in the year 1995, potato became the first vegetable to be grown in the space. So you can see that how the domestication has affected so many wild species, and they have brought into the cultivated forms by the human interference through the human management. Okay, so since we are able to grow them even in the space also. So a lot of scientific achievements have taken place. Now we will see the purpose of domestication, why we do domestication. Mainly, the man has brought wild plants under his control for various purposes. Why humans have started domesticating various wild species? Mainly for, when the agriculture has started, if you can think about it, mainly for for a few reasons like food, clothes, shelter, medicine. So these were the basic requirements of the humans when they have started agriculture. So that is why they must have started doing domestication of these wild weedy species. So these were the mainly uses of domestication. Now the process of domestication is what? It is generally believed that there are three main factors which are responsible for the process of domestication. First is natural selection. Natural selection means whatever the environmental factors, ecological factors which are present outside. So they may be responsible for domestication. And the second one is spontaneous mutations. Spontaneous mutations means what mutations the mutations which happens very spontaneously, very quickly in the nature. So maybe the domestication, the process may be due to the spontaneous mutations which happens very quickly in the nature and randomly in the nature. And the third main factor which was responsible for domestication can be carefully controlled selective breeding. That was this you can say as artificial selection, that is mainly done by humans to suit their needs. Okay, so carefully controlled. Okay, carefully controlled here means the humans are controlling the selection process according to their needs, according to their desirable traits. Whatever the traits they want, if they want the seed yield, if they want the seed weight to increase, if they want the pod weight to increase or the number of tillers to increase. So these are the various desirable characters that the humans can modify according to their needs. So carefully controlled selective breeding are responsible for many of the collective changes associated with domestication. Now you can now in this slide I will tell you what is the main difference between wild and domesticated plants. Okay, why we do domestication? To suit our needs. Then what is the main difference between the wild and the domesticated plants? Domesticated plants, they differ from the wild species in several characteristics. Okay, if you compare a wild species and a domesticated species, there are lot of changes between them. So what are the various different changes? That is plant habit, plant height. It can be plant height. So, and the second point can be resistance to biotic and abiotic stresses. Sometimes there are wild species which are more resistant to biotic and abiotic stresses. On the other hand, the cultivated or the domesticated species, they are less resistant to biotic and abiotic species. Then if you see the domesticated plants, they have more yield potential, germination dormancy, grain quality, survival in nature. Okay, the survival rate of the wild species is more as compared to the domesticated species. Toxic substances, but here you can see I may tell you that the wild species, they have more amount of toxic substances present which are not suitable for the human consumption, but in case of domesticated plants, these toxic substances are reduced through carefully selective breeding by humans through artificial selection, and then they are made ready for consumption for the humans. And harvest index. So this is the main difference between the wild and the domesticated plants. Okay. In some crops, domesticated species differ significantly from their wild species, such as in case of corn. So sometimes if you take the example of corn, domesticated species, they differ significantly. So there is a huge difference between the wild species of corn and the domesticated or the cultivated species of corn. We have seen in the last slide. So what was the wild form that was present of corn so many years ago? And after the domestication started, there was huge change in the corn characteristics after the humans have started doing domestication. And the ear size of domesticated corn is several times longer than the wild species. So this also is the result of domestication. The ear size of the ear size you can see in case of domesticated corn is longer than the wild species. Now, what are the effects of plant domestication? What happens? What are the effects of plant domestication? We will see the major effects of plant domestication is higher germination rates. The seeds they will have higher germination rates. They will germinate faster. Then greater germination predictability. Okay, predictability, that means in this amount of time the seed will germinate. So this is the predictability we can say. So the predictability also increases. More uniform timing of germination. All the seeds will germinate at the same time. So this is also the effect of plant domestication. Reduction in toxicity. Through plant domestication, we can reduce the amount of toxic substance that are present in the wild species. Okay. So through domestication, this is also one of the advantage of domestication. Changes in biomass allocation. Okay, we can modify the biomass accumulation if we want more amount of biomass in the plant, vegetative growth we want. So we can modify according to our need through the use of domestication. Changes in the life cycle. Change in quality of produce in terms of color, taste, and odor. So we can modify the characters according to our needs through domestication. And improvement in the productivity of the economic plant part. So if we are able to modify the characteristics, in turn, we are also improving our economic return. Now, the last point I would like to tell you, what are the limitations of domestication? So there are certain advantages as well as there are certain disadvantages of any technique. So there are certain limitations also for domestication. So first limitation or the disadvantage is that it is a very slow process. It takes about hundreds of years to bring about a wild plant into domestication. Okay, so if we want to bring a wild plant under domestication, it takes about hundreds of years. So it is a very slow process, we can say. And wild plants have several undesirable traits. As I have told you that wild species, they have various undesirable traits. Okay, they may be susceptible to certain things. So there are certain undesirable or those traits which we do not want. So the elimination of such traits requires continuous breeding efforts. So a lot of time is required to eliminate those undesirable traits. This is also the disadvantage of domestication. And the domestication leads to reduction in the resistance of biotic and abiotic stresses. Also, certain domesticated plants, they become susceptible to biotic and abiotic stresses. And the wild species, they are more resistant to the biotic and abiotic stresses. So this is also our limitation in domestication. And the fourth point is domestication makes the plants human dependent for their reproduction. Okay, by domestication, we are also making the plants to depend on us for their propagation, for their reproduction. So indirectly, the plants are becoming dependent on humans for their cultivation, because in the wild form, they were growing through their own. The humans were not interfering because they were wild, so they were growing by their own. So this is also one of the limitations in domestication. So here I will complete today's topic. Thank you.